Hello, and welcome to Business Matters, the show about people behind businesses that help make Tacoma a great place to live and work. I'm your host, Mike Wark. And today we tempt your sweet tooth with a visit to an award-winning Tacoma bakery. The historic Stadium Business District is our featured district of the month. And on Tacoma Means Business, Andrew Fry explains that growing a small company can be a big commitment. And today, my guest is Don Hansen, who's the owner and operator of Cascade Park Communities. Welcome, Don.
Well, thank you very much, Mike. It's a pleasure to be here.
Well, and it's a great opportunity for us and our viewers to learn more about your business, which is doing so much for seniors in our community. Tell us about your business.
Yeah, well, thank you very much for the opportunities. We have three facilities here in Tacoma, which is Cascade Park Vista, which is a 112-bed facility, assisted living facility, that's at the former Doric Hotel.
Which is right next to what we know as the Grand.
That's correct.
Cinema.
We're one block away. Yeah, right. And then we also have Cascade Park Gardens, which is an Alzheimer's, an 85-bed Alzheimer's facility in South Tacoma.
Which is kind of near Tacoma Mall.
Yeah, very close to the Tacoma Mall, South Tacoma. And then we also have a fantastic adult day health care program that we have 70 senior citizens that come in every day for a four-hour session.
You have people come in and they spend four hours there, right?
Yeah,
and
they have physical therapy,
exercise,
occupational therapy, exercise. We have socialization, and it's a great respite program for the caregiver at home because these people are kind of locked or kind of a lot of times set in their homes, and so an opportunity to get out, be involved with a group setting, and also to have the interaction with other people is a great program for the adult day healthcare program.
Yeah, and that's right there in the Stadium District, so they come in on the buses. That's great.
Pierce Transit delivers them there, and it's a four-hour session for each session. We have a traumatic brain injury group that are there. We also have a memory group that are there. And then we have developmentally disabled people who are on a separate session. So we have four separate sessions to kind of take care of each group has their own personality.
For the needs of that group.
Yeah, for their specific needs.
And then the business for the assisted living environment, that's requires employees who work 24/7, same
that's
as
correct.
The more Alzheimer focused.
Right, and so of course the challenge there is to have the right staff and the right team working together, because with 7 days a week and 24 hours a day, it's not just one group, but we have three separate groups that work it for 3 hours or for three shifts every day.
Right.
So that to have the teamwork and working together as a team, the management, our management team is great about scheduling those and having the continuity to provide the special services that we have.
And that's a very important service and a challenging one. And customer service, of course, is most important.
That's absolutely
but
true.
Some of these people are not able to help themselves.
Right.
Need special care. You need special skills. And so I'm drawn to your values. I find real interesting: compassion, competence, innovation, integrity, teamwork, accountability, quality control, and fun.
Yeah.
Sounds like a culture you're creating there.
Well, we're very proud of the culture that we've created for our family, because we consider all three of our facilities just one big family, and we're very much involved with the families of our clients and our residents. Because the families come in quite often, and that's great to have them come in and be with their either their mother or their father, or their brother or their sister. I want to say that just having the ability to carry through and have the continuity of the program, and 95% of our residents are in Medicaid, so it's a very unique service that we have in our community. We handle more than 250 senior citizens with all three of our facilities, and 95% of those are on Medicaid, so they're low income. But we're very proud to have that unique service for that in our community.
And you're not a nonprofit, you're a for-profit.
We are a for-profit organization, even though we don't make a lot of money, but at least we're surviving, and we have that unique relationship with DSHS of providing this great service.
It's a great example of business stepping up and serving a need that is often seen as nonprofit or government oriented, and finding a way to do that that works really well.
Well, when I first started the organization, I saw the need for low-income individuals, and so that was been the mantra of our whole existence for the last 21 years.
Right, and that's an interesting story in itself, and I think people interested in business would be fascinated by this, that you are a structural engineer.
That's correct.
Co-owner of a firm.
Yes, that's correct.
You did the structural engineering analysis on the Tacoma Dome.
Yes, we did.
Probably lots of other buildings across our city and in the region.
Yeah, actually, around the country, we've done several industrial-type projects also. But after 15 years in that business, as a structural engineer, I started left the firm and started developing real estate. And in the process, about 20 years after that, my father, who was 85 years old at the time, needed some additional assistance. Mm-hmm. And so I looked around to see what was available in nursing homes at that time. And I kind of determined that there had to be a better way than what was being done.
Right.
I had an architect friend who had done some other facilities, and so he said, why don't you do an assisted living facility? And I did, and it was I love the opportunity to help our low-income seniors.
So you're the definition of a serial entrepreneur with a very interesting path through the kinds of businesses you've
started. Well, it's not been a straight line, certainly. But my father, who was 85 years old at the time, halfway through construction, he met a lady who was an angel, and they got married. Mm-hmm. And my father said, I don't want to live in one of those facilities. I want to be with my honey in my own home. And they had 8 years together, and they passed away within 6 months of each other.
Wow.
But it was probably the best 8 years of my father's life.
Oh,
it was really
wonderful.
Great to see that.
So you started a business to serve your father. Your father fell in love and went elsewhere.
That's right.
But you continued serving this.
Yeah, I was raised by my grandmother, so it's always been kind of part of my thinking of working with elderly people. Mm-hmm. And now I are one. It's amazing how fast it happens.
Yeah, well, you wouldn't know by the energy that you put into all of your projects and everything you do. So what were some of the interesting challenges of going from structural engineering business to real estate into this new line of business? It doesn't seem like a natural transition.
Yeah. Assisted living is a consistent business where you're 24 hours a day,
mm-hmm.
7 days a week. Yeah,
with three shifts a day.
Three shifts a day, and having
staff.
The continuity from one shift to the next, and also the continuity from one day,
right,
from the weekdays until the weekends.
Mm-hmm.
So there's that continuity that's a real challenge. My personal, I guess, capability is in the organizational ability to put together a management team that is able to provide the teamwork to accomplish that goal of having the consistency and providing the great service that we provide.
Do you find that one of the focuses of your efforts is ensuring that that culture of quality with accountability?
Well, the term quality control is a constant to be consistent and to provide that. And of course, we're surveyed and inspected by the state, and we've been very fortunate to have no citations for the last three inspections that we had.
Mm-hmm.
So we've got a great relationship with DSHS. They appreciate us, and we appreciate them.
And you've continued to expand. You didn't just stay with your assisted living facility. You got into memory care and the daycare.
That's correct. It's been a progression. We saw a need for more memory care because so many of our residents at Cascade Park Vista were needing a memory care facility. So we converted our South Tacoma Cascade Park Gardens to a memory care unit from an assisted living.
Mm-hmm. And then found a new property to develop these.
Yeah, right. And then we also saw a need for adult day health.
Mm-hmm.
So we started off with one client back in the year 2000, which was 16 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And that would, now we have 70, and we're increasing that up to 80. That's our goal for this year, is to increase it to 80 average daily attendance.
Mm-hmm.
So we have, you know, 120 employees, and to pull them together as a composite total for our culture is, we are very proud of the fact that we've been able to do that.
Yeah, I would think so. And I'm proud of what you're doing and glad you're doing it. That, those kinds of services are so important, especially for the people dependent on Medicare to get through, and to know that there's this level of quality and people who are looking to make it work. What do you see in the future?
I see a continuing need for, there's more and more senior citizens that are needing assisted living, memory care, mm-hmm. Traumatic brain injury services. And so I certainly see more of a need. I'm not sure that we can take care of all the needs coming up in the future, but like I say, depending on what happens with some of the regulations that we have, mm-hmm. for example, the Affordable Care Act is a very expensive program for us,
mm-hmm.
and also the minimum wage. Mm-hmm. Minimum wage is also a challenge,
mm-hmm.
and so we have a continual need to increase our reimbursement, and the of course the state has their budget requirements,
mm-hmm.
and restraints, and so we have to continually be aware of what's happening with the state and to allow them to increase the reimbursement rate.
So it's a very complex business to manage and navigate, and ever-changing, continually looking for ways to be sure that you can continue to do what you do.
Right. If you stay still, you'll go behind. And so we have to continually look at new ways to continue our services.
Well, I find that your experience, Don, is a great example of what someone with an entrepreneurial spirit can do to address a problem in our community and really make a difference.
Yeah.
So thank you for sharing your businesses and your experience with us today on Business Matters.
My pleasure. I really appreciate it, Mike. You've been a great facilitator.
Well, thank you. Stay tuned. Coming back with Business Matters, we'll take a look at Tacoma's historic Stadium Business District. Connecting people to business is what Tacoma is all about. The Stadium Business District is a mix of history and opportunity, filled with family-owned stores and restaurants.
Hi, my name is Leah Knoll, and we're in the historic Stadium District. The Stadium Business District Association is all about promoting the local businesses here in Stadium.
We represent our businesses with critical issues that we take to the city of Tacoma. We're also members of the Cross District Association, which helps our businesses locally.
And we do that by making sure that this is a desirable place for people to visit and to live.
A lot of the cool features around the Stadium District start with the Stadium High School. It's an iconic building that's been around for a number of years.
We are just north of downtown. It's very easy to get here off the freeway, and just awesome businesses here, and also really great people.
We have the huge Wright Park, which is located right in the middle of the Stadium District, with the Seymour Conservatory, open to all people to come and look at the beautiful flowers that they grow in their arboretum.
Residents here have a wide variety of businesses for their everyday needs, the grocery store, their dentist, their nail salon, multiple hair salons.
We have a major hospital, we have an auto body shop, we have a dental office.
Pubs, restaurants, a theater. We have it all.
The Stadium Business District helps our businesses by providing events throughout the year.
Such as our annual, very popular art, wine, and beer walk.
We have our Street of Treats that it goes along on Halloween.
We take care of the beautification of the district.
The future of the Stadium Business District is really exciting.
We have about 70 businesses here in the district, and about 55 are members. And if you're not a member, then you need to contact us to become a member for all the wonderful things that we do.
We're going to have Sound Transit's light link rail come right through our district. We also are revitalizing with new apartments for to bring in a lot of people to do a lot of things and visit all of our wonderful businesses in the district.
It's a very walkable district. You can walk to the grocery store, you can walk to all of these different businesses, take care of everything that you need, and you don't even have to move your car. Both Val and I live and work here in Stadium because it is the best district in the city.
Yes, it is.
For more information on experiencing Tacoma business, log on to experiencetacoma.com. When we return on Tacoma Means Business, Andrew Fry will explain the role of commitment in growing your small business. Small business is the backbone of our economy. On this edition of Tacoma Means Business, Andrew Fry talks about the challenge of making your business grow.
So after years of giving advice on small businesses and how they can up and operate and succeed, I would like to talk now about taking that small business and then growing it. Because at some point, especially if you've been running your business for a while, you may want to grow. Now, if you do want to do that, there's some things that you can think about before doing so. Because remember, your company will change dramatically. You may be the same name, you may have some same core people, but the company, because of its size, is going to be different. So here's some things to do if you want to grow your small company. Number one, commit to growth. It's not one of those things you put your toe in the water and then you decide, oh, it's working, let's grow even more. You need to make a commitment to grow your company. Number two, a larger business is going to take a different and broader mindset, knowledge, and skill base than a smaller one. So get ready to do a little bit of cooperative management with others who have skills that can help a larger company. Number three, be prepared to collaborate. If you want to grow your company and if you want to make a bigger impact, it's likely that you're going to be part of an ecosystem of solution. So look around at other businesses who might be worthwhile collaborating with. In other words, if what they provide for their customers is something that isn't in competition with yours, but can be collaborative with yours, those are business deals that you want to make, because then you can do more outreach into their market. So then the next thing that you're going to need to do is standardize on a lot of your procedures. One of the things that is a problem with being a larger company as opposed to a smaller one is that you can't oversee everything that's going on. And if you happen to grow into different cities, how do you know those companies in those cities are following the same blueprint that you are? So you need to standardize on a lot of your different processes in order to make them work. Then, in terms of identifying yourself and growing and yet maintaining what you've built and who you are, consider what your core competencies are. What is it about your company that makes you different? Now, what I've done just recently is I started a small company of doing escape rooms. The core competency of the rooms that we've built are that they're very theatrical. So if you know if you're gonna do an escape room through something that we've done, it's gonna be theatrical. That's a core competency. And then finally, what is your competitive advantage? So if you're gonna be going out to this larger market and you wanna be a larger size, what do you have that differentiate you at that larger scale? So those are a number of things to consider if you're going to be taking that small company you've been running for the last 3 to 5 years and saying, time to go big.
Thanks, Andrew. For more ways on helping grow your business, check out Tacoma's Community and Economic Development Program at TacomaMeansBusiness.com. When Business Matters returns, we feature a Tacoma bakery specializing in decadent desserts for anyone's taste in the spotlight. On today's Business Spotlight, the focus is on Corina Bakery, a sweet Tacoma business with tasty treats and more.
My name is Molly Ott, and I'm the general manager and co-owner of Corina Bakery. I love the work. No 2 days are the same. It is a business, for the most part, that is based around happy times in people's lives. We planted our roots in Tacoma because we wanted to be in proximity of our family and friends, and we have grown to love the community, and we hope that they love us as well. We try to listen to what they say to us and offer the kinds of services that they're looking for. The early days were tough, as I'm sure every small business or restaurant owner can attest to. The uncertainty of what each day would bring, the fear of failure, all had their role in the beginning. I just realized that in order to be successful, you have to be there all the time. Not necessarily to micromanage per se, but I think that you need to be down in the trenches doing the things that you're asking your employees to do, and not just managing, but kind of managing by example. When we created the look of the bakery, the theme that I kind of had in mind was that of a balance between feminine and masculine, so that everybody who comes in here would feel at home, maybe relate to you know, their surroundings, the atmosphere. As we all know, atmosphere is a big part of why you want to hang out in a place. And we found out about Corina being for sale through a mutual friend. We decided to go ahead and move on it. The people who we bought the bakery from were a couple who actually worked at Magnolia Bakery in Greenwich Village, New York. So that's what kind of sprouted the idea of Corina, and Corina was their daughter's name. And I liked the name, and the bakery had, you know, started to get a reputation, and I thought, you know, we're just gonna go with this. It fit, and it's a lovely name. We're proud to have it. My philosophy on baking is make a good quality product consistently and give your customer base what they want.
That's it for Business Matters. Join me next time for more insight into the Tacoma business scene. See you then.